Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's broadcast, Breast Cancer as a Global Disease. Are we up for the challenge? Presented by Dr. Benjamin Anderson, Professor of Surgery in the Division of General Surgery, Surgical Oncology Section at University of Washington School of Medicine. I'm Dr. Susie Valdez of Lab Roots, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We're delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by Lab Roots. Lab Roots is the leading scientific social networking website and producer of educational virtual events and webinars. Before we begin, I want to remind everyone that this event is interactive. We encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want at any time you want during the presentation. Just click on that Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen. Type the questions into that drop-down box that appear on that screen. Our speaker will respond to your questions via email. If you have any trouble seeing or hearing this presentation, just click on that Ask a Question box and let us know you're having some trouble. This presentation is educational and thus offers continuing education credits. Please click on the Continuing Education Credits tab located in the top right corner of your presentation window and follow the process for obtaining those credits. Please join me now in welcoming our presenter today, Dr. Benjamin Anderson. I will now turn the presentation over to him. Welcome, Dr. Anderson.
Thank you very much, Susie. I'm very pleased to be able to speak with you today and to make this presentation. What we're going to be talking about today is breast cancer as a global health issue. And breast cancer as a global disease is in fact a major challenge for us around the world. And there are opportunities, but also limitations in what can happen. I'm looking forward to providing information to you about this. The Breast Health Global Initiative began in 2002 as a jointly sponsored project between the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center and Susan G. Komen for the Cure. Let's begin by talking about global cancer trends around the world. Actually, the differences in distribution of cancer around the world do relate to economic development, at least in terms of the cancers that are most common and least common. In the highest income countries, the breast cancer, lung cancer, colorectal cancer, and prostate cancer are the majority of cancers that are diagnosed. It's important to remember that in addition to causes of cancer, there are differences because of screening. When we screen, we find more cancers. When we go to medium income countries, there are cancers that are associated with infectious origin and environmental origin, particularly in the GI tract. And in low income countries, cervical cancer is the most prominent disease that we have seen historically. But it's important to recognize that these are not fixed figures. They're in fact changing over time. So in 2008, there were 12.7 million cases of cancer. This is predicted to rise to 22 million by the year 2030. And what you can see is that there are some cancers that will be increasing and some cancers that are decreasing. So those cancers associated with infections will be decreasing because we are in fact doing better with them and we're finding ways of avoiding the infections that cause these disease processes. On the other hand, those cancers associated with reproductive, dietary, and hormonal factors are increasing. Breast cancer is one of those. So in terms of these etiologies of these cancers, the source of the cancer does relate to what the best treatment management strategies or prevention management strategies would be. Those cancers associated with infections, such as cervical cancer, which is associated with human papillomavirus, or liver cancer caused by hepatitis, or gastric cancer caused by H. pylori infection. These are areas where vaccination is a primary source of management. By preventing the cancer from occurring in the first place, this is a very cost-effective way of addressing these cancers, where treatment can be very difficult. So liver cancers are hard to treat because the liver operations are difficult and the effectiveness is challenging even in high-income environments. Cancers associated with behavior, such as tobacco-associated cancers, this is also an area where prevention plays a primary role. There is no useful application of tobacco. One of the statements that's commonly made is tobacco is one of the products that when used as directed will kill you. And therefore, prevention is a primary role. When we have cancers where primary prevention is a beneficial strategy, that is where we want to go. But for cancers where primary prevention does not explain the majority of cancers and therefore is not a benefit, we have to go through a process of early detection, correct diagnosis, and treatment in order to improve outcome. When you look at those factors that are associated with breast cancer, the risk factors for them are in many ways areas that we are not able to change the outcome or we perhaps don't wish to change them. So avoiding alcohol, avoiding hormone exposure, avoiding radiation, these are areas that is difficult to make major changes. Having more lactation is helpful and weight control is of course desirable. But the main limitation with breast cancer is even with all of these risk factors, these only explain 20 to 30% of the breast cancers that are diagnosed today. And so if that's the case, then what we are really looking for are healthcare systems that can address that cycle of early detection, diagnosis, and treatment. Now, looking at the distribution of cancer around the world for breast disease, you can see that the high-income countries, such as the U.S., is where we see the greatest incidence of breast cancer. This is in part related to screening, because when we look for the cancers, we find them. When we look at breast cancer mortality, you can see that the two are mirror images of each other. So here is incidence, here is mortality. It is the same areas where incidence is lowest that mortality is the highest. And this speaks to the benefit of early diagnosis, finding the cancers before they are very advanced stage disease. Mammographic screening is the one test that has been shown to reduce the mortality of breast cancer. And so we can attribute about 23% benefit in terms of overall mortality reduction to breast cancer by virtue of the use of screening. Well, there certainly is controversy about mammographic screening. Is it possible the areas where we're doing this too much? Are there areas where we're actually over-diagnosing breast cancer? This goes beyond the scope of today's talk. But overall, the great majority of experts around the world agree that there is a approximately 20% mortality benefit to mammographic screening at a minimum for women ages 50 to 65. When we start screening, you'll see that it changes the distribution of these cancers in ways that one might not have predicted. So mammographic screening really got going in the U.S. in the early 1980s because the HIP trials in the 1970s showed this mortality benefit. What we saw in the U.S. was rising rates of early stage cancer, the node negative cancers and non-invasive ductal carcinoma in situ. The node-positive cancers, the more advanced cancers, it was assumed that the rate of those node-positive cancers would drop when screening got going. We, in fact, did not see that. The more advanced cancers remained at approximately the same level. This suggests that there may be a difference where some cancers are amenable to early diagnosis, while others are going to be biologically aggressive regardless of the timing of their diagnosis. That's where treatment plays a critical role. But what we did see in the U.S., about 8 years after screening started we started to see a drop in breast cancer mortality beginning in approximately 1990. It's been dropping by 1 to 2% per year since then, And overall, we now have a 35% decrease in breast cancer mortality in the US in comparison to 1990. So while we may have controversy about screening, it's hard to explain the benefit and those outcomes without attributing screening to be playing a role in this. So early detection is essential to improve outcome. I think our evidence is clear in this regard, but it only works when it is followed by appropriate breast cancer treatment. So actually, to save lives, screening must be linked to timely, effective treatment. It's not early detection that saves lives, it's early treatment that saves lives. What you can see on this graph is that with modeling, it's the combination of screening and treatment that creates the outcomes that we want to see both in the US and around the world. But when you look at the patterns in different countries, you can see overall this rising incidence of cancer, particularly in high-income countries, but also middle and low-income countries. There was a peak that occurred around 2000 that has leveled off in high-income countries, presumably because we've, to a certain degree, saturated ourselves with that screening. Middle-income countries, such as those in Latin America, here exemplified by Colombia and Costa Rica, also seeing a rising rate of breast cancer. Where they, screening has just been getting established in these areas, so that's part of this, but also people are living longer. This is true in low-income countries, such as Sub-Saharan Africa. Now, what you can see here is that in the high-income countries, breast cancer mortality has been dropping. And some have argued, well, that must be just related to treatment. Perhaps that's just because they're wealthy and therefore treatment is provided. But you will note that, and while in middle-income countries, we've not seen the same mortality benefit that has occurred in the high-income regions. But you will notice that there are high-income countries where we have not yet seen that drop in breast cancer mortality. These are same countries, in this case here, Singapore, Japan, and Korea, where mammographic screening has not taken off in the same way that it has in the US and European countries. There, we need to learn more about it, but again, it does speak to the potential value of mammographic screening globally. But we have an issue in terms of trying to address cancer, and that's because around the world, the amount of funding going to cancer has really been inadequate. So here you can see that while 4.8 million deaths result globally from cancer, a much lower amount of funding is directed toward cancer in comparison to infectious diseases, including HIV, TB, and malaria. And so we have an inequity in terms of how cancer is funded that is needs to be addressed. Actually, the United Nations has led the way beginning in 2011 with a high-level meeting that showed us that they wanted to redirect the World Health Organization to begin to talk not just about infectious diseases, but also about non-communicable diseases called NCDs. And it's the NCDs where the direction for WHO is now going. The NCDs include heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, and cancer. And so that has provided a new direction for us. But we have to recognize that resources are limited and we therefore have to adapt what we do. Looking at total national health expenditure per capita, this ranges from $22 per person per year in low-income countries up to over $4,000 per person per year in high-income countries. So we cannot realistically just apply the same approaches that we use in high-income countries to regions that have less funds to distribute. The Breast Health Global Initiative formed for the purposes of starting to address how would we manage breast cancer in these limited resource environments. Expert panels were pulled together in order to create consensus opinion and to publish outcomes. We held two global summits in 2002 and 2005 and created what we'll talk about in a minute, the concept of resource stratification. We had two summits where we then talked about implementation and healthcare delivery. And the last global summit until the present, 2012 in Vienna, was about supportive care and quality of life. And the core concept that was advanced in these global summits is this idea of resource stratification, that resources that are applied to cancer management vary in their relative necessity. Basic level resources we defined as those that are core resources without which one cannot anticipate improvement in outcome. So breast cancer surgery would be an example of this. We do not have a way to cure breast cancer today that does not involve removal of the primary tumor. Limited level resources, the second tier, were those resources that one would anticipate based upon high level evidence would make major improvements in survival. So most of our treatment strategies, such as drug therapies, chemotherapy, endocrine therapy, fit in that category. We created a third level called enhanced level resources. These are services that may be very valuable and helpful, but may or may not improve survival. So for example, performing breast conservation therapy, that means a lumpectomy and radiation. This will improve outcome. This will not improve survival in comparison to mastectomy. It's equal in terms of overall cure, but it does make the therapy much more acceptable. So there may be better participation by women when they are able to preserve the breast in comparison to when they lose it. And then there's some resources that actually are of lower priority because they're very expensive and may not improve on outcome, such as PET scans or breast MRI. We may use these a lot in high-income countries, but if you ask how many women do better by virtue of getting a better picture of the breast, the answer is zero. And that's because we already know that removing the entire breast is not better than doing breast-conserving therapies. But it's important to know what not to do in comparison to what to do. And so these tables, healthcare systems, early detection, diagnosis, and treatment by stage, these are the four levels of standard resources that were laid out in the BHGI guidelines first published in 2005. So in terms of early detection, what are those basic level resources? Well, that's taking a history and performing clinical examination. Diagnostic imaging actually comes before screening. So in particular, the use of breast ultrasound, this is very helpful for the evaluation of breast masses. By getting a better image of what we feel in the breast, we actually may be able to avoid biopsies. And mammographic screening, this is the first point, but probably within limited populations or target groups. It's the annual screening or every other year screening is at the enhanced level. And that's because of the resources that are required. There are many things that need to be set up before mammographic screening is realistic. In treatment, what would be basic? Well, performing a modified radical mastectomy and standard systemic therapy for locally advanced cancers, chemotherapy, endocrine therapy, these are those resources where one begins. Now consider this example from Vietnam. Back in 2011, this was the K Hospital in Hanoi. This was the cancer facility that was available. When we visited this area, what we saw was that on the right, this is a standard room that where patients were located. There are four beds in that room, and there were two or three patients per bed. And this is actually not what our Vietnamese colleagues were focused on. They did not recognize this as a fundamental limitation. What they did want us to see was the molecular pathology unit that they had recently opened. And they were very excited, very understandable, but when you asked how is this going to help, actually that was not clear to our Vietnamese colleagues. So this is an example of where the resources and the perceived need for resources were different. I'm in no way being critical of our Vietnamese colleagues. Actually, molecular pathology is precisely what we talk about the most in high-income countries. But one must have a prioritization before those become relevant. I will tell you that things are much different today in Vietnam. The K Hospital is recently being rebuilt. Progress is being made around the world. Now, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, NCCN, has now adopted resource stratification within their guidelines. These are the most commonly quoted guidelines for cancer around the world. Now they have created resource stratification to cover over 75% of cancers around the world. Breast cancer is among them. And they used a system based upon the Breast Health Global Initiative approach modified to use in the NCCN framework. The idea is that using different levels of resources, that we can identify what should be done or what is not necessarily to be done depending on resource limitations. In addition, it was recognized that there are some interventions that might be done based upon low-level resources that we might not do at the high level today. So here is the enhanced level guideline for breast cancer by NCCN. And what you can see is that breast MRI and PET scans are not being used in that environment. When we go to the core level is the same as what we termed limited in BHGI. This is where we start to see the use of tools that are less expensive but can achieve reasonable outcome. So in place of CT scans, the use of chest x-rays, abdominal ultrasound, and plain films can be used in place, and in fact was what we used back in the US before CT scans were available. At the most basic level, we see the minimum use of resources. So for example, HER2-new testing would not be appropriate either at the basic or at the core level, and that's because trastuzumab, the therapy that is associated with HER2-new testing, is also not available. So when we look at those basic level resources, what do we see? We see basic diagnostic workups and that are available. The World Health Organization has been the global leader in health management. And the WHO actually has been now adopted resource stratification within their own framework. Last year, 2017, a cancer prevention and control initiative was adopted. And what you will see here is that they have now stated that the Director General of WHO should develop or adapt stepwise and resource stratified guidance and toolkits for addressing cancer. And we were really thrilled to see that WHO now also is using this resource stratification approach. But in order to apply these approaches, one needs to know what is in existence at present. And so situation analyses are a core value. We did a project in Mexico, the Latin American Early Detection Initiative for breast cancer called Lady Braca, in which we evaluated in conjunction with INCAN, which is the National Cancer Institute in Mexico City, the fundamental resources for screening. The healthcare system had adopted mammographic screening. The question was, is this going to work? The purpose of this analysis was to identify gaps and barriers. Barriers were identified both in terms of awareness education. It was shown that knowledge about self-care increased likelihood of having a mammogram by over twofold, and that also was associated with increased likelihood of early diagnosis. The concept was to do remote screening using telemammography, but there were issues that had not been recognized. For example, internet adequacy is a problem. Bandwidth is an issue when one is trying to send images. And so in addition, the use of the BI-RADS system, where one rates the mammogram according to the BI-RADS scale 1 to 5, and then obtains a biopsy. Core aspect of BI-RADS is that the radiologist needs to know what happens after the biopsy is performed. Was it cancer? Was it not cancer? That feedback had not been established. So recognizing this is an important step to initial intervention. Now, in the staging of cancer, in the US and in Europe, 90% of cancers are early stage, 0, 1, or 2. By contrast, in India, over 3/4 of cancers present as locally advanced or metastatic disease. As a result, we recognize that in the setting of India, it's difficult to improve an outcome because even with all of the resources available, it's hard to make major shifts in breast cancer mortality in the setting of stage 3 and stage 4 cancer. When we talk about advanced stage cancer, this is really problematic. The next picture is difficult to look at, but is in fact the reality of the world. These are photographs of breast cancer provided to us by Dr. Peter Bird, who is a breast cancer surgeon in Kenya. And this is commonly what he sees in his clinic. It illustrates why mammographic screening is not the beginning point in sub-Saharan Africa, because if you can see the cancer from across the room, you most certainly do not need an imaging test to amplify that ability to diagnose it. It's not the beginning point. When we started our work, one of the critiques we received was that some countries are so poor that breast cancer is just not a significant problem. At least that was the assertion. But that does lead to a question. At what point are resources so limited and competing demands so great that breast care programs make no sense to create? We went to Ghana in 2004 to try to address this issue. So Ghana in Western Africa is now a lower middle income country. At that time, it was a low income country. This is the Komfa Enoche Teaching Hospital. It is associated with the medical school. There is a nursing school and a dental school. And this was the breast clinic where women came to have their breast health issues evaluated. This picture was the earliest stage cancer that I saw. You will note that the patient's left breast is higher riding than her right. And that's because of the 10 centimeter mass that the clinician could feel in the breast on clinical breast exam. What was much more common was this presentation, the ulcerated tumor. And this is a setting where palliative care is really the best that one could hope for. This is an example of a patient who had a modified radical mastectomy, but now clearly has a bad axillary recurrence. This is a terrible health issue. And the point is that we need to address the cancers in ways that are with effective therapy. It was not effective in this patient's case. When we asked patients, why do you not come to the hospital? We found that there were beliefs that were major obstacles, such as, cancer is invariably fatal. Why would you go to the hospital if they were just going to tell you you were going to die? There also were social misconceptions such that a woman might have been doing something wrong in order to create her breast cancer. That is not true, but nonetheless was believed. And then they would also say, why would you go to the hospital? They'll just cut off your breast and you'll be dead in 2 years. And in fact, the system was making this true. And that's because at that time, women would show up at the hospital, they would receive a mastectomy for their locally advanced disease, but they would not receive either radiation or drug therapy. It is predictable that if we perform a mastectomy but do not treat with adjuvant therapy, it is very likely to recur with advanced stage disease. And therefore, the system was making this belief true. That's a problem. In addition, there are competing healthcare environments. This is a billboard. You can see that in the upper right, you go to the herbal clinic and they claim they were treating breast cancer. And so because of this competing healthcare system, this is where patients typically went first, leading to delays in diagnosis. Here we saw the multidisciplinary clinic. The gentleman in the front was the one pathologist for that 1,000-bed hospital. The lady to his right was the one radiologist for the same facility. What we found is obstacles within the system. Patients were presenting with advanced stage disease. They were receiving mastectomies without adjuvant treatment. But when we looked at what that one pathologist was able to do, for that 1,000-bed hospital, what was very common was that pathology reports would take 4 to 6 months to generate. That is an example of a basic level resource. If you cannot prove that something is cancer within 4 to 6 months, you cannot anticipate major improvements in outcome. Now, Dr. Bafour Awa was the radiation oncologist, head of the cancer clinic, now head of the hospital in Ghana. He and Dr. Helga Stalsberg was a pathologist who met at the Global Summit in 2005. Dr. Stalsberg suggested that they could make major improvements in outcome by virtue of a training program. And so they set up a program where pathologists, of which there were an inadequate number in Ghana, would go to Norway and have special training slots set up. So this was not costly, it was just creating an opportunity for them to learn. They also trained the technicians, which was critical. And what they found was that within 14 months, they could have a histopathology laboratory up and running in the same facility. So the point here is that just putting money into systems is not necessarily the outcome. Of course, resources are needed, but often it's a matter of organizing the system in ways that are effective. Last year, we performed a situation analysis with the Ministry of Health in Tanzania and the Susan G. Komen Foundation. This was appropriate in Tanzania as the ministry was recognizing because breast cancer was rising at the same time that cervical cancer was decreasing and life expectancy was increasing, meaning that more women are going to be living into the years where breast cancer is going to be the dominant cancer problem. So in Tanzania, which is in Eastern Africa, we visited different sites and we learned about their healthcare system. This is a report that is now available online. So in this organized system, going from the primary health clinics at the bottom of the pyramid, that's where patients first present. They progress to the district, regional, zonal hospitals, ultimately receiving treatment at the national hospitals. What we learned was that while patients presented initially with that primary care level, the initial diagnostic biopsy was not available until level 4. And that means that women would have to go first to the district, then to the regional, then to the zonal hospital before they could even get a biopsy. So as you can imagine, fewer women would make it through the system. And as a result, it's in essence a filter where only the women with the most advanced stage disease would end up getting diagnosed. Only those with the most miserable problems would make their way through. And that is the major limitation. Either one needs to make needle biopsy available at a lower level, or you need to provide direct connections from the primary care center to the zonal hospital. Today, the Ministry of Health is working on making needle biopsies available at the regional hospitals and creating direct referral from the primary care level setting to make this system work. But how, in fact, are we going to implement these changes? How can we make this happen in realistic fashion? Breast Cancer Initiative 2.5 is a global campaign to reduce disparities in breast cancer outcome for 2.5 million women by the year 2025 or 2030 in alignment with WHO goals. So a group of organizations, as you can see here, came together, including the Breast Health Global Initiative, to try to address these outcomes. Because at the system level, this is more than what we as clinicians think about. So we talk about the hospital, but tend to forget about the other groups that actually are critical to our outcome. So it's the government, it's the ministries where core decisions are made. This is where allocation of resources takes place. So while we might think that the healthcare minister that is the core issue, actually it's the finance minister. Those are the people who actually allocate those resources. And it is civil society, it's the patients, it's the advocates. These are the folks that drive the changes. So we have to be able to communicate among these three groups with the same language, even though we live in three different worlds. The BCI 2.5 created what we call Globam, which is a data resource that is available online and is currently being updated. You can go online, you can identify individual countries and download existing data from WHO and the World Bank about resources that are currently available and about the current presentation of cancer. And by taking this data, you can perform comparisons between different countries to see where resources are available. We also created a set of knowledge summaries. These knowledge summaries provide that core information about planning healthcare prevention, early detection, treatment, following WHO's pathways. And what we put together in these documents, in addition to the clinical component, are the policy components that go with this. This is important because policymakers often are not medically trained and certainly are not going to spend the time to understand our Kaplan-Meier curves. They need to know what are the key issues that need to be addressed. Similarly, our advocates and civil society needs to know what is appropriate for bringing in. So the idea of going and advocating for mammographic screening in an environment where women are presenting with cancers that are visible, that is not the next step. We have created these situation analysis tools so that we can survey what resources are available. And in addition, we recently published a model that can help communicate to ministries. The idea, of course, is that when we have cancer, there is a point at which it is diagnosed and death will result in those cancers that are not treated. When we provide treatment, this prolongs survival and cures some patients. When we then add early diagnosis to this through screening, we see further improvements beyond that. This is the conceptual framework, which is not adequate to speak to healthcare ministers that need to make rapid decisions about resources. They need to understand how much of a benefit might be attributable to this. So here in the example of Tanzania, we have the current standard today, that which relates to mortality after 5 years. And what our this intervention shows that as we introduce screening and downstage disease, as we add therapies, that we can see gradual improvements in outcome. So the blue bars are when endocrine therapy alone is available. The red bars are when both endocrine therapy and chemotherapy are available. And this can be shown in terms of what years of life saved after 5 years. A minister will understand this data well. These are the people, this is their population. These are voters. So understanding this is essential in communicating. And this is what led us to this concept of phased implementation, the idea of going through steps in order to make improvements in outcome. You have to go in stepwise fashion, and you have to be able to measure your outcomes in order to make this difference. Published last year in Lancet Oncology is this phased implementation approach as applied in Peru. So Peru is a middle-income country in Latin America. And the idea here is recognizing that the healthcare systems are different from what we typically think about. First, we need to have standard guidelines and protocols, and we need to have a trained healthcare workforce. So using resource stratification, such as NCCN, is a good stepping point. But we need educational materials. Providers that have never seen early stage cancer will likely not recognize it. Someone might say, well, that's not breast cancer, it's not ulcerated. Well, of course, that's a lack of education to providers that working up palpable lumps is appropriate and necessary. Training about how to perform clinical examination is a necessary step. These gentlemen are learning fine needle aspiration, which is an affordable technique for evaluating tissue. And so developing systems where patients are triaged is critical. Just like in the Tanzania example, we in high-income countries tend to assume that the resources and locations are available as if the patient lived next door to the cancer center, when in fact the cancer center may be hours away from where they live and not that many patients are going to go. So PATH led a program where the clinical breast examination and community education occurred at the primary level. Initial tissue sampling with fine needle aspiration was performed at the local hospital, which is accessible, and it was FNA that was used to decide who needed to go to the cancer center versus who is not. So that this is actually a triage approach, which is essential to functional healthcare systems. Now, fine needle aspiration, there's controversy about its use. It used to be highly used in the US. Now, most centers do not use FNA, but instead use core needle biopsy. The problem with core needle biopsy is it's very expensive. Relatively speaking, the needles cost $30 to $60 and they should be single use. By contrast, fine needle aspiration can be performed with about a $5 charge when you look at the cost of the glass slides and the needles, but particularly relevant if the person who is performing the FNA can read it, one can get essentially an immediate result and the patient can receive triage. They do not need to wait a day or two to find out what those results show, which if you traveled many hours to get to this place, you might not be able to stay that period of time. But a limitation of FNA, it requires expert cytologic input. But are the two tools competitive? No, they're not. They can be used in different settings. And in fact, FNA as a triage tool is a different question than FNA for tissue sampling for core needle biopsy. So how then do we adapt these resources in ways that are effective? We need to consider these approaches for scaling up. So we might develop this model, but then we have to be able to expand it in ways that are useful at a country level. Here in Peru, you see educational programs. This is a nurse midwife providing education about basic breast health. And the goal is to scale this up, also considering the use of special tools such as ultrasound. Ultrasound can both improve diagnostic input and can limit the number of women that may need to go. A simple cyst is something that does not require further workup. So in that PATH model, creating a program that can be scaled up at the national level, that is a core value. Next week, we will be operating the Breast Health Global Initiative, our sixth global summit, and it is going to focus on this phased implementation. Our first day will be on phased implementation for early detection. Day two will focus on phased implementation for treatment. And day three will focus on integration with existing healthcare systems. So when we see diseases as competitive, gosh, I'm a breast cancer person, which means I'm not an HIV person. Both diseases lose. And when we have that frame of mind, when in fact it is a shared infrastructure that makes both of them work. That's how we're going to make progress. So finally, I'd like to talk about implementation research. This is how do we make a difference in implementation by virtue of studying its applications. In Colombia, a national early detection program was adopted in the early 2000s. But the problem was that it was not being implemented. So although it was stated that all women 50 to 65 should have a mammogram at least every 2 years, this was not in fact taking place. And so they performed a cluster randomized trial where in clinics, there was an intervention, but the intervention was on the clinic. They provided training and education about screening, how it is done well, its value, and then they followed to see how this compared to the control group where there was no specific intervention that was performed. At that time, fewer than 20% of women in the core age group, when they came to the facility, were offered mammographic screening. What you can see here is that in the intervention group, the number of cancers was increased relative to those patients who were in the control group, where there were fewer cancers found and more were advanced stage. And it was the following year that in the intervention group, fewer cancers were found, presumably because they had been already identified at earlier stage, where more cancers were found in the non-intervention control group, but at a later point. An outcome that was not anticipated was that in fact, more women successfully had breast conservation by virtue of that early diagnosis. So the point here is that when we introduce screening, not only can screening improve outcome in terms of stage of diagnosis, but we may be able to conserve the breast more often, which makes the intervention more acceptable. This is the sort of thing that we can study well in the setting of implementation research. Here is a study that the Breast Health Global Initiative helped support in Indonesia. The idea was that nurse midwives and volunteers were trained in clinical breast examination. Women then came to the facility and received both a clinical exam and a mammogram, and results were compared. 1,179 women underwent both mammographic screening and clinical breast exam. Approximately one quarter of them needed a diagnostic workup. It is often underappreciated that when we do screening, a significant fraction of women will need a workup, even though it is a small minority that will end up having cancers. In fact, 14 cancers were found, about 1.2%, which is about what one expects in mammographic screening. But of importance, in Indonesia, of the 14 cancers that were found, 13 could be appreciated on clinical breast exam. Now, this does not mean that mammography is unimportant, that even though in that setting it only added one patient. The point here is that in an unscreened population, clinical breast exam is the point to begin. That is where we start. But what happened was that in follow-up, 8 of 14 never received treatment. When we investigated why, 2 refused and 6 were lost to follow-up. So the point here is one needs to be certain that the system is going to function and those patients that are screened will follow through to have treatment that's available. Now, what do we know about clinical exam? Actually, in the early trials, 60% of cancers could be found initially on clinical exam. There are some cancers that are appreciated on clinical exam that are not seen on mammograms, particularly in dense breasts. So clinical breast exam is necessary whether or not it improves outcome in terms of survival. There is a trial going on in India in which women are being randomized to clinical breast exam versus control follow-up. And what we're seeing in the early stages of this trial after 3 cycles, we can see that the early stage disease is becoming more common in those women who undergo clinical breast exam, while the incidence of the advanced stage disease is not changing. That's the lower left graph. Mortality has not shifted in India by virtue of this yet, but it may be that this is a matter of time. You will note this pattern looks very similar to the pattern for screening mammography, as we saw in the early trials. Not all of the mammography trials showed survival benefit. This is the Canadian trial, which is the most commonly cited source for those that question the value of mammographic screening, because when screening was started in Canada, they in these trials, the overall survival was the same with 25 years of follow-up. This has led some to criticize the Canadians and question whether their mammography quality was good or whether there was a selection bias in terms of how the trial was done. But what is often overlooked in the trial was that in that control group, the women who did not receive mammographic screening within the setting, the median tumor size was approximately 2 centimeters over the duration of the trial. This is very different from India or sub-Saharan Africa. So I would suggest the most interesting aspect of the Canadian trial is not about whether they were doing mammography well, it's about what were they doing in the control group? How did they get the tumor size only 2 centimeters with clinical examination alone? Because that's the application for countries that cannot afford mammographic screening. We also have to recognize that there are delays in diagnosis. So here we're looking at a study performed by Dr. Anya Romanoff in Peru. Every patient presenting to that that regional cancer center in the north and saw a surgeon with a new cancer diagnosis was surveyed. Outcomes as related to delay in diagnosis was evaluated. And what you can see is that there were patient delays, meaning that while the patient appreciated symptoms, on average, over 200 days was between the initial presentation that they appreciated and that initial diagnostic workup. But further, there was a delay in the healthcare system by an even greater amount between the initial presentation to the initiation of treatment, 241 days. Of note, 93% of the breast cancers were self-detected. So while we might, in some settings, we critique the value of clinical of self-examination, in fact, it's the only tool. And therefore, we have to recognize that it's our entry point, as imperfect as it might be. With that overall delay of 407 days, they found that the prior exposure, prior use of clinical breast exam had a significant benefit. So these are women that said that someone had done a clinical breast exam in the past. And they found that there were those patients who at some point before had had a clinical exam, had less delay and were more likely to present with early stage disease. So we forget that clinical breast exam has an educational component. By performing a clinical exam, we're helping women understand what it is that we're looking for. And that difference, that benefit in clinical exam persisted even when controlling for economic level and insurance source. So it wasn't just that they were in a better system. So clinical breast exam absolutely has value in limited resource environments and may have more value in high income environments than is recognized based upon our randomized trials. So overall, what we see here is that we're dealing with systems. We need to, on the healthcare side, have early detection, diagnosis, and treatment in a functional way. But in addition, there is a public side that needs to be performed as well. We need survivors, because it is the survivors that organize into advocacy groups. They are the ones that both interface with the government, and they are the ones that create awareness. It's the advocates that create awareness that help women understand why they should be coming in. It's not listening to your physician that's the key. It's listening to survivors that is the key. Therefore, we need to understand social beliefs. This is the last study I'm going to show you, which is a study performed by Dr. Rola Shaheen, who is a radiologist, formerly at Harvard and now in Toronto. And what she was examining was women in Gaza, or Gazan women outside of the area. It exposes an important concept in terms of how women believe about cancer. So when these women were surveyed, over 90% were willing to have a mammogram if they felt something wrong in the breast, that is, if they had a symptom. They also believed that survival would be improved if the cancer was earlier in its diagnosis. But if you ask the women how many were willing to have a screening mammogram, meaning that they felt nothing wrong, but they were going to get this test, actually, now it was the minority that were willing to participate. And really, when you think about it, in our healthcare system, we have our own belief system as well. So we tell women, come in, get a mammogram. We're going to get this picture of your breast, even though you feel nothing wrong. Then we're going to tell you there's something wrong with your breast. Then we're going to operate on you. Then we're going to give you drugs that makes your hair fall out. Then we're going to burn your skin with radiation, but great news, you'll be better after we do this. It's not hard to understand why someone from a limited resource environment would say, that's crazy, I feel fine. Why would I come in and do those things? So we all have our belief systems. I do think ours is based on evidence, but that doesn't make it less of a belief system. So in summary, cancer is increasingly affecting countries at all economic levels, while the healthcare investment is failing to match the challenge. Resource stratified guidelines provide a framework for prioritizing sustainable healthcare strategies. These baseline assessments are necessary to determine steps for sequential programmatic building, those situation analyses, and then we use phased implementation to define sustainable approaches that integrate into existing healthcare systems to improve outcome. Ultimately, then, implementation research is the basis by which systematic improvements can be measured. I do believe that we will be able to see a drop in breast cancer mortality around the globe. We just have some serious work to do between now and then. Thank you very much for your attention.
And thank you, Dr. Benjamin Anderson, for that informative presentation. We will now start the Q&A portion of our webinar, and we'll address some of the most commonly asked questions by our viewers. If you have any questions you'd like to ask, please do so now. Just click on that Ask a Question box located on the far left of your presentation window. Type your questions into the box that appear on the screen and click the send button. Our speakers will follow up with you via email. So let's take a look at our question. Why is the average age of breast cancer younger in sub-Saharan Africa than it is in the U.S., Dr. Anderson?
Well, thank you for that question, Susie. Actually, we look at cancer distribution, and it is commonly said in sub-Saharan Africa and in Latin America that this, and parts of Asia, the assertion is cancer must be different biologically in these limited resource environments. And the reason being, it's argued, that we see more women diagnosed in their 40s than in high-income countries where the average age is in the 50s. However, when you consider the example of Tanzania, you can realize how the healthcare system is actually making this true. So when we do not do screening is best at finding cancers in women 50 to 65. That's the area where it is of clearest benefit. There are fewer cancers to find in the 40s on average, but if we do not do screening, and if we have a system like Tanzania, where only the women who are having the biggest problems end up getting a diagnosis, then that it's a selection process. Well, who has the most aggressive advanced disease? It's the young women with the triple negative cancers that will ultimately have these symptoms. So actually, when we introduce screening, the average age of breast cancer diagnosis will rise. There is an epidemiological result of screening that is often not appreciated.
Thank you. And Dr. Anderson, are resource stratified guidelines actually providing support for substandard care?
So that early on was the very criticism that we received in writing these guidelines. People would say, well, you're certifying substandard care as being adequate. That is not the concept of resource stratification. Resource stratification is about prioritizing how to advance our systems in an appropriate way. So instead of fast forwarding to mammographic screening that would not be functional, using clinical exam is an initial step. The goal is to get all of these systems to progress, but you have to do it in an organized, stepwise fashion. And this is the framework for that setup.
Thank you for that. And Dr. Anderson, one of our viewers wants to know, what are the NCCN harmonized guidelines, and how do they help care in low middle income countries?
So after NCCN did the resource stratified guidelines for cancer, the question became, how do we use this? And so a special program that was a collaboration between the NCCN, the American Cancer Society, the Clinton Health Foundation, and IBM, they organized a group called the African Consortium for Cancer, where 12 different sub-Saharan African countries were brought together and asked the question, would they like to use the NCCN guidelines? And what our African colleagues said was, we don't want a whole set of guidelines. We want a guideline that we feel is appropriate for our resources in sub-Saharan Africa. And so through a series of meetings, they identified where they thought sub-Saharan Africa mapped in that basic, core, and enhanced levels. And that single harmonized guideline or set of guidelines is now available on the NCCN website. A similar project was done in the Caribbean, and those guidelines are also available. And it's very interesting to compare where the Caribbean countries thought they mapped versus where the African countries mapped. So the point is that by using resource stratification, you can create opportunities for people in region to develop their own approaches that are not making mistakes.
Thank you. And we have one final question, Dr. Anderson. How does breast cancer present in underserved communities in the U.S.?
So we like to think of the U.S. as a homogeneous country where healthcare is available. And it's very clear that actually healthcare is not available to all, that we have our own settings, and that there are underserved communities where disease presents at later stages and access to appropriate treatment is much more limited. One of my colleagues, Dr. Pat Morgan, previously worked at Memorial Sloan Kettering in the Upper East Side of New York, but has since moved to Mamanis Hospital in Brooklyn. And the point that he makes is that when one looks at the breast cancer distribution between these two hospitals, Memorial Sloan Kettering looks like our standard high-income country settings, whereas the distribution of breast cancer in Mamanis in Brooklyn looks like a middle-income country, more stage two and three, less stage one. That is crossing a river. So the idea that it's all geographic, no, it isn't. It's about healthcare distribution, and we have to think about how we to best address our limited resource environments within the U.S. as well, if we're going to see improvement in the U.S. population health overall.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson. Thank you for your important research. Would you like to provide our viewers with some closing remarks today?
Well, I feel that we have so many opportunities to improve an outcome. And right now we're in this debate in the U.S. about whether we provide healthcare or not to the general public. And I think the belief system that needs to be challenged is this idea that we cannot afford healthcare for all, at least in some basic level resources. And the idea that we don't provide for prenatal vitamins, but then we do pay for the premature child, that's financially unsound. So we need to recognize that it's actually unaffordable to not provide healthcare. It's just we need to make smart decisions about how to do this in ways that are evidence-based.
Well said, Dr. Anderson. Thank you again for your presentation and your research. I'd also like to thank LabRoots for making today's educational webcast possible. Before we go, I want to remind everyone that today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through January 2019. You'll receive an email from LabRoots letting you know when the webcast will be available for replay. Please share that announcement with your colleagues who may have missed today's event. That's all for now, and thank you for joining us. We hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.